Hello, you're watching Kitco News, and I'm Michelle Makori. I am pleased to welcome my next guest. He is the largest independent financier in the commodity sector, and he's now saying that going green is the next way to strike gold, that carbon credits are the commodities to watch out for. Marin Katusa is a world-renowned speculator, fund manager, and founder of Katusa Research. He is also a New York Times best-selling author, and his latest book is out, The Rise of America, Remaking the World Order. Marin, thank you so much for joining us.
It's my pleasure.
All right, Marin, we have a lot to discuss, including those carbon credit opportunities and a very deep dive into your book, The Rise of America. But first, I want to get your reaction to the latest news from the Fed, which has now raised its expectations for inflation and has moved forward the timing of its interest rate hikes to 2023. Markets have been struggling to process this, gold suffering its biggest one-day percentage drop of the year on Thursday, dropping nearly 5%. So what is your read on all of this, Marin?
As you've read in the book, you know, I know everyone watching the Kitco site wants gold to go from bottom left to top right in a straight line, but that's just not the way it's going to happen. You're going to continue to see volatility, probably see further downside pressure. But it does show that the Fed is trying to adapt to what is going on. And look, like I talked about in the book, there's crossflation here. Some are calling it transitory, but there's certain places where you have significant inflationary pressures. In others, you see deflationary pressures. But the number one thing that you can take away from this is how fragile the economy is and the markets, with something of the Fed talking about something 2 years out, what it does to gold today. So expect more volatility. And you know, don't freak out about the 5% drop in the gold price, because if the gold producer you're invested in isn't making hay at this price, you should probably sell it anyways.
You should be getting out of what gold positions, you're saying? Your gold producing positions?
If they're not making hay, like, this is an incredible price for the producers. And if your producer can't make incredible free cash flow at, you know, the current price of $1,780 per ounce, you shouldn't own that gold producer to begin with, because it's just a crappy gold company.
Telling it like it is, Marin. All right, you did touch on crossflation, which of course you go into detail in your book. Fed is still insisting that inflation is transitory. Explain what you mean by the concept of crossflation, that there are certain sectors that will have deflation and others that will have inflation. Can you break that down for us a bit?
Sure. Let's focus on the energy sector as a perfect place. So you look at the coal sector and the natural gas sector, you're going to see a lot of continue to see deflationary pressures. For example, the coal ETFs got literally delisted. That means those got sold off. Because the utilities are forced to get away from coal. You know, over 50% of the U.S. electricity generation a decade ago was coal. Now it's less than a third, and it's going to continue that trend. So that's deflationary pressures. Money's not going to be invested in there. The utilities don't want it because of the pressure from just the whole setup. But then you're going to see, you know, significant pressure in certain pockets for the green energy, because now you're getting so much money moving into that sector, into certain areas and projects. So you see, you know, wage inflationary pressures, material pressures, you're going to see a lot of that. So that's what I meant by crossflationary pressures. So you're going to see the deflationary pressures in the coal and the natural gas and, you know, the old economy. And then the new economy is going to have some near-term inflationary pressures. And you're seeing it right now in the markets.
And Marin, as we know, the Fed has been grasping onto this 2% target of inflation. That is the sweet spot. And it's interesting that in your book, you discuss, well, how did they even get to that magic number? How did that 2% inflation rate become the target for all central bankers? So why don't you explain that for our viewers?
We'll give away the goods of the book, sure. Essentially, it goes back to, that was the actual annual growth rate of gold production annually for over 100 years, if you annualize it. So that's how the 2% was frameworked in the economy. But it was actually New Zealand that was the first central bank to actually peg it to 2% based off of that gold. And they were able to take their inflationary pressures, it was north of 9%, and within a couple of years got it to that 2%. That became the role model for all the other central bankers. You know, in a long story short, that's essentially why the 2% is the magic number.
All right. Again, these are all the themes that you get into in the book. And of course, it's all interlinked. But the central theme of the book, as the title would indicate, is that we're just at the cusp of the rise of America, and that you disagree with those that say that this is the beginning of the end of the era of America. Now, I certainly hope you're right. But I do want to break down that premise a little bit, and starting with the dollar, because there's a lot of concern that the Fed may mismanage this whole situation and that the fiscal policies of the Biden administration are going to debase the dollar. Yet in your book, you're confident that the dollar is not going to be losing its status as a global reserve currency. So why do you think the dollar will not be dethroned?
So it's all about the dollar. You know, whether you're looking at gold, oil, any commodity, you have to focus on the dollar. It is the king and it will continue to stay. So whether you talk about demographics, you know, China just came out with the multi-child policy. They're trying to push because it's all in the math. China has horrible demographics. Then you look at just the resources in America. People forget, you know, just 15 years ago, I remember I made a lot of splash when I called bullshit on peak oil. And a lot of guys were like, no, this is the end. Well, then there's unconventional oil, and that changed the game. And America, which was supposed to be so dependent on oil, became a net exporter of it, right? So you look at how innovation and technology, and don't forget, technology is deflationary. Software is eating the world, and it's going to continue to do so. And you've seen it in the oil patch. The mining guys are a little bit slower to catch on to the technology. And I'm involved in many mining companies. So pushing technology on the mining guys is a little bit harder, and they're slower moving than the oil patch guys, but you see it, it's happening. And you just look at, you know, will the Fed mismanage it? Probably. They're human, but these are smart people. And, you know, many of my closest friends, guys that I manage their money, like Doug Casey, have been talking about the end of America for 30 years. The point here is that as bad as it is in America, would you rather take the ruble, the peso, the yen, the yuan, the euro, as bad as the mismanagement of the Fed, it's still better balance sheets per GDP, per ratios than Canada or the euro or the yen or China. So, you know, America is the easy target to take on, and I get all that, but I break down every chapter why don't underestimate America and just pull back. You know, where do the richest of the Asians send their kids to university? Are we sending our best and brightest to Beijing University, or are they sending their brightest to Harvard and Stanford and MIT? Another thing, I talk about Jack Ma, what happened there. Imagine what Elon Musk would happen to him in China if he was Chinese. After that, within 18 months, when SEC went after him, Elon Musk became the world's richest man for a brief period of time. What happened with Jack Ma for just, you know, making one comment publicly against the regime?
Right.
So, you know, everyone that thinks America sucks and it's the end of the American empire, they need to get on a plane and travel and see the rest of the world.
So I like to use the metaphor that no matter what, it's still the cleanest shirt in the dirty laundry hamper. And that seems to be the argument that you're putting forward as well, that, yeah, things could be bad back here, but they're even worse elsewhere, if I'm understanding you correctly.
Yeah. And at the end of the day, look at military power, technology power, the markets, the innovations. Are the best companies in America trying to list in China? No. Are they trying to list in the US? Vice versa? Of course they are. You look at the technology gap that I break down with what's going on with Israel and how their companies are investing into the US market. So there's so many aspects here moving on. And I get it. The gold guys, the gold bugs of our market, that this audience, Kitco, they don't want to hear my message, and that's fine. But you might want to open up the macro perspective and challenge your thesis, because, you know, if you want to understand what's going to happen in the commodity space, you need to focus on what's going to happen to the US dollar.
All right. I think our Kitco viewers are open to a range of perspectives, Marin, but look at the counter to the argument would be that every fiat currency has collapsed, that mankind has debased hundreds of currencies through the centuries. The British pound, the Spanish peseta, even the Portuguese escudo were all at one time in history as mighty as the dollar is today. And there's also the notion that the US could be seen as weaker on the world stage, which many feel it is under current leadership, and that there's a pull to the left in the country, and that there would be no consequences for not paying back dollar-denominated debt. And that at large, the global economy is starting to lose faith in the dollar. Now, you combine that with the threat of a Chinese digital currency, that China will potentially spearhead a new version of Bretton Woods that will use a basket of central bank digital currencies that could then erode the dollar because the digital yuan and other CBDC exchanges wouldn't need to use SWIFT. And that is, of course, the messaging network that's used in money transfers between banks that is monitored by the US government. So these arguments, particularly the CBDC one and the way it would work against SWIFT, are all moving forward to say that all of this could erode the strength of the dollar. What do you say to that?
The opposite will happen, actually. If the yuan and CBDC are, who's going to accept it? Do you want to get paid digital yuan? I would short Vancouver and Toronto real estate out of the gates because that's been a great loophole for the money coming out of mainland China for that. That's just one microcosm effect. If you look at, you know, talking about that China, America's weaker under this administration, again, that's also false. If you look at what the first plan under the Secretary of State, Anthony Blinken, what he first went and did was repair the EU relationship. You see, Trump, I'm apolitical. I'm Canadian. I don't care who's left or right. I just look at the cards that are dealt and how to best play this. But you look at what Blinken did. He went to France, repaired the relationship there. Then he went to Italy and Germany. And you see that what Trump did was he alienated the euro over the NATO, wanting to make, pay their share, and then took on China. So he China said, okay, well, we'll play the US. We'll play the EU versus off of the US. So Biden's come out and openly stated, hey, Russia, I remember my first book is essentially the Cold War, understanding where the Russian play in this whole resource sector. We'll let you into this international play, but you got to play by the rules. And the EU is in line now with the American agenda. And also Japan, South Korea, India have all lined up with the Americans. So I would argue that under this administration, the American power globally is stronger than under Trump.
And what would you say to the argument that you have the countries that the U.S. has sanctions on, if they want to use an alternative monetary system to get away from that, that creates a stronger position for this Chinese central bank exchange? And that is a way for it to grow and over time supersede the dollar. And again, for the record, I really hope you're right.
So let's use an example. Let's use Iran. Iran's probably the best example of what you're saying. Iran's had no choice but to accept the terms and conditions that China represents because of all the sanctions the US, the EU, and the allies of the US have imposed. But do you think now under a regime change of the Iran, they're going to accept those conditions of China? So if anything, you're as strong as your weakest link, and China's full of weak link allies.
Okay. Now, you said in the book, though, that either scenario with what happens in the U.S. and in the dollar, that it's good for gold, that gold is one of the few assets that benefit from either outcome. And because it is and it has always been money, it will maintain its status regardless. Explain that.
Sure. You look at the history of gold. You look at the lending of it. You look at the properties of the gold. And more importantly, you look at from when I've been talking about the positive swap line nations and negative swap line nations, you look at the growing taxes and ownership that's happening in the negative swap line nations. The negative swap line nations are going to try to get more of that gold.
I just want to interrupt you there for our viewers that are not familiar with the positive and negative swap line system. Can you just break that down for us?
Sure. So there's 14 swap line nations, but EU is 28 or 29 in that setup in itself. Then there's subcategories. But essentially, if you're a true ally of the US, you have swap lines. And we've seen what happened in March, April, May of 2020. The negative swap lines is everyone who doesn't have a swap line. And if you look what's going on in many parts of Africa and South America, if you're a swap line ally, you're not going to bite the hand that feeds you. Now, it doesn't mean you're going to get permits in all areas. It doesn't mean these mining companies can run around with no oversight. It just means that after you do get your permits, they can't steal it from you. Or if it means that after your permits are and your mine's operating, they can't change the terms. And you're going to see, well, we've already seen it. You know, there's 15 countries just in the last 12 months that have already changed the rules, the ownership, the taxes, the royalties on these foreign companies. And more importantly, you know, at the end of the 90s, the whole mantra, essentially under Barrick and Peter Munk's, he made the quote famous, go to where the gold is. There's a huge movement of going under the Lundins and what Ross Beaty was doing. These great mining entrepreneurs went to these developing areas and they brought North American technology, North American money. And 20 years later now, these foreign countries want their fair share. Now define fair share. So you're going to see the reversal of it. Remember, everything is cyclical and we're seeing it. And I think that what you want to be focusing on is on positive swap line, tier one assets with tier one management teams. And this whole belief that you have to invest in juniors to get the big gains, for years I've been publishing data that shows that's not true. So there's a lot of the game has really changed because of the passive management, the ETFs, the gold ETFs, and what the criteria for all this. And I just think that a lot of investors are mispricing political risk. For example, a lot of analysts are putting an NPV, a discount 5 for something in, you know, Argentina, where you'll never get a permit, versus something in Idaho or Nevada or Quebec. Doesn't make sense. The other thing that nobody is putting into their NPV analysis is the future liability costs of carbon. And that's going to be a huge one. And I've been talking about this for a couple of years, and I put it into all my NPV. So the business is based off of raising money. The mining business is very capital intensive. And they try to downplay these risks. But I think that's going to be very, very dangerous for many investors.
And you're very adamant as well that you recommend, you caution against gold ETFs in your book. That was certainly one of the big takeaways for me from reading it. Now, you mentioned carbon, and that, of course, is the big, big giveaway in the forbidden chapter, how you're emphasizing that this is where the future is headed. I've had the pleasure of interviewing a few Canadians recently since joining Kitco, and you guys love your hockey metaphors. And you've said that you like to be where the puck is going. And one of the biggest points in the book is that you see the move towards conscious capitalism, a prioritizing of ESG issues as the big opportunity, and that corporations are going to need to focus on their carbon footprint. So break that down for us.
So essentially, as I discuss in the book and every chapter, it comes down to cost of capital. That's what it's all about for mining companies and any company, essentially. So if you look at a mining company with one mine, you're looking at a cost of capital anywhere between 8 and 13% money. And that's expensive. And that's what you call junk bond territory. But by going ESG, there's trillions and trillions of green capital in the green bonds that the mining guys just don't qualify. And you wouldn't believe how many guys I've laughed at my idea. And I said, all right, you're a walking zombie and you just don't know it. There's not trillions and trillions of dollars on the sidelines for these mining companies, but there is for green bonds. So the mining sector can either pick up its game, reduce its cost of capital, and attract more investors into the sector because they can increase their free cash flow. For example, let's say you're a one mine copper company. Your cost of capital is roughly 10%. But by meeting the ESG categories, remember, carbon credits are a commodity. This is this misconception. People think it's a tariff, it's a tax. They're just too lazy to actually do the read and understand the sector. A copper company can spend just a few million dollars to reduce its carbon footprint and actually produce carbon credits, go net zero, do what they need on the S&G, the social and the governance aspects, and their cost of capital can go from 10% to about 4 to 5%. Now, what does that mean? Well, if you've got 500, let's say $1 billion, that's probably the starting point for a 150 million pound copper porphyry. So you're looking at $1 billion capex at 10%, that's 100 million a year. Well, if you go down to 5%, that's 50 million. But that same company is only going to make 50 million of free cash flow. By reducing your interest payment by 50 million, you've just doubled your free cash flow by just being a little bit outside the box and going to, like you said, Wayne Gretzky's comment, where the puck is going. And that's where the sector, that's where the capital, that's what the criteria is. So if companies like Apple and FedEx and Google, they're all very ESG conscious. They're all in the commodity of carbon credits. They're producing carbon credits. And these mining guys are just so focused. Well, we produce gold, we produce copper. Well, they need to produce copper carbon credits also.
Break that down. Who issues the carbon credits and how do you produce them? Do you produce them by having projects that are environmentally net positive? Is that how you create a carbon credit?
So there's many ways to produce a carbon credit. So let's say if you're a diesel powered mine, many mines are actually diesel powered. So if you do energy fuel switching, so if you go from diesel to a clean power or cleaner power, you're going to get a carbon credit. Now, who credits these? Unfortunately, it's not going to be some banker because I'm sure the cost would get very expensive, but there's actually certified companies like Verra or the Gold Standard. These are certified companies that are actually globally recognized that come to your project. And it takes a year, 12 to 18 months to actually go through the process. And it's no different than a copper or gold project. You got to start through all the different steps to go through it. Now, that's one example. Another example of how you can produce carbon credits, like I talk about in the book, my favorite form, or what I call blue carbon. Blue carbon are, you know, there's 14 million acres of mangrove trees. And I personally put up tens of millions of dollars to do this. Why? Because these mangrove forests, the forests in the ocean, are getting clear-cutted, but nobody's talking about that. Everyone talks about the Amazon forest getting clear-cutted, but the Chinese shrimp farmers are actually clear-cutting this because it's the ideal habitat for shrimp farming. But what happens when they do that? You lose the coral, you lose the sharks, the turtles, the whales, all the marine biodiversity. But the blue carbons are trading north of 35 bucks a ton right now.
Where are they trading? When you say that, so fine, yeah. you plant some trees.
Goldman Sachs, there's ETFs, there's in the US, in the US New York Stock Exchange, on the European London Stock Exchange. You have a brokerage account, you can buy all these, you can start buying carbon credits. Everyone talks about Bitcoin and these thousands of cryptos. Look, I'm like I said in the book, I'm not anti-crypto, I've got money in the sector, but I don't see a bigger opportunity. And it's not just me. I was the first guy in our sector to talk about it. But just yesterday, the CEO of Trafigura, which is the second largest commodity trader in the world, came out and said, quote, carbon credits are going to be 10 times the size of the oil market. In my book, I said it's going to be bigger than the oil market. If the second largest commodity trader in the world, who they're the second largest in trading oil and copper and nickel, is saying that, well, they've already put up billions of dollars to get into the carbon credit. So obviously he's talking his book, but it's tens of billions of dollars are going into this already. And if the mining companies want to reduce their cost of capital, mining companies can qualify for ESG. I'm just trying to push everyone into the sector. Every company that I invest in, and I become a major shareholder, usually number one or two in the company, they have to accept this mandate or I won't put my money with them because their cost of capital is going to be higher, which means I'm going to make less money.
But how does the retail investor now cash in on this trend, recognizing that this is where the puck is going, that carbon credits are going to become even more and more important and more valuable as corporations have to meet certain criteria? How does the retail investor play this?
Just like in the gold market, there's ETFs that buy carbon credits. There's companies that produce carbon credits, or you could actually buy the carbon credits off these exchanges like Verra or Gold Standard or any of these globally recognized carbon credits. The only thing I would caution people is don't buy carbon credits pre-2017. They weren't, I don't want to call it bucket shops, but it really, you know, after the Paris 2015 COP, it kind of really changed and matured versus the Kyoto Protocol of 1998. I don't believe in the older credits because they're not as valuable. They're being soaked up by the airline industry. They trade anywhere between $3 to $6 a ton. Personally, for me, the gold, the commodity of, you know, if you want to say gold to the carbon credits would be blue carbon. You can get terrestrial carbon credits through, you know, rainforests, through planting and harvesting of the forests, through trees. That's another way of doing it. So there's many ways. And just like a mining company, mining companies can get involved in producing these carbon credits. You know, there's only 180 million carbon credits created last year, and all of them, any quality one by the four main certifiers of these carbon credits, they're soaked up. You know, Shell, if, like I explained in the forbidden chapter, if you just took the big three oil companies, there would be 150% shortfall. That's how much. Shell came out and said, we need to buy over 100 million carbon credits a year for 30 years. There's only 180 produced last year. Exxon, think about this. You think about T. Boone Pickens' era where he had to buy 5 or 10% of a company to change management. That's what made him famous. The little engine 2.0 for $20 million was able to turn Exxon's board upside down. That's the most powerful oil company ever. For $20 million, I guarantee you that the Exxon board spent more than $20 million in legal fees to fight this little fund that bought stock. And now Exxon has to get in there and start buying carbon credits. Chevron, BP. So it's going to start with the oil guys because they, you know, they're S1, S2, and S3s, as I explain in the book. But it's going to go to the mining guys. So, and it usually, this starts with the big guys in the industry. But this is interesting where it hasn't. So the Don Lindsay's of the world, I'm calling you out because you missed the boat on this, where usually in the mining world, the bigger you are, the lower cost the capital you have. Now a little mining company, by going net neutral, can have a lower cost of capital than a big company. And that's a game changer for the sector. So if you're run by a savvy management team that understand this, and trust me, there's many guys who are very savvy in doing this. Look at what Ross Beaty is doing. He didn't become a billionaire because he got lucky. This is uber smart. Or Sean Rosen, uber smart. Follow those guys because they're all doing this. Not just some guy out of Vancouver talking about this. It's happening in real time.
And as you say in the book, Marin, whether you are a proponent of climate change or not, it's irrelevant because this is where things are going. This is the trend. But ultimately, it's an opportunity to make money. And as you say, capitalism can indeed save the environment. But on top of that, you mentioned that it can also help in the so-called geopolitical positioning and fight, if you will, against China. Very quickly, if you will, break that concept down for us.
Sure. So Amazon's not very happy with me right now. I had the number one book in the world last week, and they took me off. Now, why did they take me off their platform? Because I said Jeff Bezos became the world's richest man, like the Walton family with Walmart. But ironically, they're also the largest facilitators of pollution on the planet. Now, imagine this. If Amazon just went onto your profile and you said you want to go net zero for carbon, China is not going to pay for their carbon footprint. Put it this way. Just China's annual concrete consumption is greater than the carbon dioxide of every car on the planet combined every year. Okay. So even if we all went Teslas or all electric, whatever, it's still not going to make a difference. That's 4 billion tons of just concrete consumption China's doing. We have the technology today. Amazon has the technology that they know every product. They know the carbon footprint of this pen or this microphone or computer. But now with the incredible stimulus happening in the US, the low cost of green energy and robotics, it's going to be a game changer and it's going to happen. And more importantly, the pension funds and everyone's going to invest in this. So they've already started this by going low carbon. Look what Lundin Petroleum did. They have a lower cost of capital than Exxon or Chevron because their oil field is net zero. They announced that they went net zero. They went and bought carbon credits and they went and did a big bond for 2% money. Exxon can't get money at 2% today in this market. So this is happening. Then that oil is certified as net zero. It goes into the refinery, and now the refinery gets credits for that. So it moves down the chain. That's we're going to see that across the board. So if you just take the US consumer off of Amazon, it's something like over $500 billion a year. Remember, China's number one customer is the American population, and then number two is the EU. Imagine what would happen to China if you're, you know, you have your tax, your shipping, and it said your carbon footprint. You can buy that gadget out of China, or you can buy it down the street from Amazon, and you're not going to pay that carbon tax. Most people say, hey, I'm going to go clean if it's the same price or better in the US. And that what would happen to the geopolitical situation in China? That's going to be a severe, like, so for the, if I was Taiwan, for less than the price of two jets, they can convert this whole semiconductor game by putting this into play. And I could do, that's the ultimate Trojan horse from a geopolitical standpoint.
Well, Marin, a lot to get through in the book. Can't really give our viewers all of it in this interview, but hopefully we've whet their appetite. I, as I said, read it cover to cover, thoroughly enjoyed it, thoroughly enjoyed the historical background that you give in every chapter. Really recommend it. The Rise of America, Remaking the World Order. That's the book. Marin Katusa is the author. Thank you so much for joining us.
It's my pleasure.
All right. And thank you for watching Kitco News. Remember to subscribe. We'll see you next time.